Good evening all. Thank you all for finding time and visiting today's webinar. My name is Abhijit Mandal, Assistant Professor, ASBM University. Our university has established by Government of Odisha with a mandate to set best standard in imparting value-based quality education that builds leadership. This NewGen University founded and led by Professor Biswajit Patnaik, former professor of IIM Indore and Lucknow, and a widely acclaimed management guru known internationally for his expertise in the domain of human resource management. ASBM now offers courses in business management, it means undergraduate to PhD level, and we are also planning to introduce innovative courses in the field of law, economics, education, social science, and skill development. Now I'm requesting all the participants to check if you can see and hear us well. If you have any question during the presentation, just write on the chat box. And please mute your audio and video. All the participants, I'm requesting you, except the panel members. Today's topic is empowering business with big data and analytics. And we have three eminent speakers from the different domain, like IIM, NIT, and IIIT. And before we start, let me explain why we choose this topic for this webinar. As we know, enterprises are leveraging cloud services to improve efficiency, increase agility, and unlock new opportunities. But every business is unique. And how do you find, or how do you define the right model for your needs? So many experts says that when big data projects fail, it's often because you know that the companies have not clearly defined their goals. So the analytics problem, what they have chosen, or what they are trying to solve, or the measurement they have all used for the success. So the information gap is there, and it's playing a very important role. So what is that information gap? So this making the enterprise bleed actually. So decades back, if we look at our upper generation, we can find out the people who already had an account in a bank, and or simultaneously every other representative from the banks, they are getting different kind of phone calls or different kind of messages, okay, to open a new bank account or some kind of bill payment reminders even after paying the bills. So these are the glaring example of the gap between the customers and the organization due to the lack of centralized system. So why we are talking about the centralized system? Because the big data, we know the data, but what is small data and what is big data? That I think our eminent speaker will explain briefly. And whatever the data in a centralized manner we are keeping in a different a platform, so that unified view of the data and that employees, that will have the enterprise wide. So the decision taken by the enterprise are always uninformed, which results in negative customer experience, and addressing the pain points means later which becomes a headache. So that's where the big data technology comes as good news for the enterprises. And the big data, we are talking about the big data. So big data that actually provides the consolidated data that works as a single source, and that is truth for the enterprise, every enterprises. However, the harnessing the real potential of the big data is all important to visualize the data effectively and derive valuable insight out of the data in order to make the intelligent decision. So, we don't take much time. We have to. We can begin, and let me introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Rahul Kumar from IIM Sambalpur. Let me explain. Introduce himself. Dr. Rahul Kumar is an assistant professor in the area of information system at IIM Sambalpur. Prior to this, he was at XIMB Bhubaneswar in the decision science area. There, he was joint coordinator for the executive MBA program in business analytics. He holds his doctorate FEM from IIM Ranchi. Post PhD, he had a brief stint at industry as an analytics consultant at Infosys Consulting. By background, he is an engineer from BIT Mesra Ranchi. Prior to joining IIM Ranchi as a doctoral scholar, he was working as a manager at Jusco Private Limited, a Tata Steel subsidiary. His research interests are recommender system, text mining, machine learning, and NLP. He has authored articles in several reputed journals such as Information System and E-Business Management, Journal of Behavioral and Experimental Finance, and International Journal of Operational Research. He is also a reviewer of many seminal journals and is currently the guest editor for Journal of Decision System, Taylor and Francis. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you so much.
And our next speaker from NIT Patna, Dr. J.P. Singh. Dr. Jyotipokesh Singh is an assistant professor and head in the Department of Computer Science in NIT Patna. He has co-authored 7 textbooks in C programming, data structure, operating system, ad hoc networks. Apart from this, he has more than 30 international journal publications and 50 international conference and proceedings. His research interests focus on social media mining, deep learning, social network and information security. He is a senior member of IEEE and ACM, life member of Computer Society of India and Indian Society of Technical Society, IST, and Institution of Engineer. He is an associate editor of International Journal of Electronic Government Research and guest editor of Multimedia Tools and Application. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Abhijit. Thank you. Thank you for this nice introduction.
Welcome, sir. Our next speaker from IEEE Dharwad, he is very young and very energetic, Dr. Sunil Soumya. And unfortunately, it's not unfortunately, I came to know that Dr. Soumya is a scholar by Dr. J.P. Singh. And he received his B.Tech degree in Computer Science and Engineering in 2012. He received M.Tech degree in Computer Science and Engineering from VTU Belgaum, India in 2014. He received his PhD from NIT Patna in 2020, and he is currently joined as an assistant professor in IEEE Dharwad, and he joined IEEE Dharwad soon after his thesis submission in July 2019. His area of research includes applied machine learning, deep learning, information retrieval, and he has 10 research publications, research papers and accounting. Out of that, 5 research papers are published in well-reputed SCI Index journal. And he has also published a few international conference papers, and he has also delivered a lot of talks on machine learning and deep learning on the various engineering colleges and throughout the nation. We welcome Dr. Sunil.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone.
Okay. Welcome, welcome. Dear participant, if you have any question during the presentation, you have to write your query on the chat box, and after that, we'll have a question answer session at the end to answer your question. Again, I would like to call Dr. Kumar to inaugurate the session. Sir, please.
Thank you so much, Professor Mandal.
Yes.
First of all, let me extend my gratitude to ASVM University for giving me this opportunity to connect with Onda's dignitaries and various audiences. So I also extend my warm welcome to the audience and participants. Hope this 1 hour of discussion turns out to be fruitful for all of you. By that, let's first understand the various tenets of today's topic. So it's all about empowering a business with big data and analytics. So as far as the conceptual underpinnings are concerned, Professor Mandal has already decoded that etymology. So the way I had started, he has already done the ground ceremony for me. So he used various keywords such as decision making and data driven decision making, decision support system, deriving insights, deriving valuable insights. So the main idea of today's webinar or this session is to connect those dots, because whatever he has been pointing at are basically that those keywords define the boundary or a premises of a business in today's data-driven ecosystem. So my objective will be overall to just connect the dots, and let's see whether we can understand how the threads of that fabric are knitted around. So with that, let me first start with the term big data. So I have come across various academicians, industry practitioners, and even scholars of management science and otherwise engineering domain. So whenever the term is coined or tossed as big data, so the first perception which comes at the top of mind that something, it's going to be very huge, it's going to be uncontrollable, it's going to be unmanageable. But let me tell you, audience, that's a myth. Because big in size is just one of the dimensions of big data. So that size as a dimension, we cover up in a pillar of volume, because big data is standing on typically five pillars currently. So we had, like, the field of marketing has evolved from 3 P's to 5 P's to 7 P's. Likewise, big data analytics has also seen the transformations from 2P to 3P, and now we are standing on five V's basically of big data. So volume remains the pivotal part, which actually defines or hints towards size. So maybe other eminent speakers are a better person to speak on, to shed some light on that area. They will of course touch on, given their background of use of machine learning and deep learning, because that hosts and cater to how to handle huge data sets. So maybe they'll throw some light. But before I get into or leave the baton to them, so apart from just the volume, which's a proxy of size, there are other dimensions as well, which comprehensively explain the nature of how a big data should be. And the second most important pillar is the velocity, the speed in which the data is hitting into the system. And of course, not just the speed of data, say in today's e-commerce portal, you can see a lot many subscribers or IP addresses hitting on the same point of time. So that's the velocity, which was otherwise not observed a decade before. We were mostly relying on physical stores. So what kind of a footfall we used to see? We used to have an exponential distribution or a Poisson distribution to map that. But that's not possible. Every second, we can see thousands of users logging in. So that's the difference between an e-commerce ecosystem in the cyberspace and what we had traditional stores, and especially in terms of business. So when we move from volume to velocity, we also have variety in data set. So it's not just only about numbers. It's about whatever way the information is conveyed. Now, traditionally, it is again perceived that if information is perceived, it has to be referred through or percolated through numbers. But that may not be always true. Whatever I'm speaking, I'm dissipating some information. And I'm uttering, not even uttering a single word over there. So variety in terms of data explains that number is a subset of it. We can have text, or say the way we speak, we can have communication channels, the way we write, the way we say convey English language to our targeted readers, images, expressions, video, and various such sources comprehensively touch on the nature or the variety of data. So that also explains and differentiates a normal data vis-a-vis what a big data can be. And then we have an element of veracity, which has of late picked up attention of and gathered attention of scholars of the domain. Veracity is about the credibility, the trustworthiness, the precision we associate with the data. So whatever pre-processing is done, and finally, when we are deriving and banking on such insights, we need to be very sure that the source is credible, the way we have pre-processed, and whatever machine learning algorithms have crunched it after data mining and text mining and other such processes, they are giving us meaningful insights. But at the end of the day, what should we derive out of those insights? Yes, machine learning and other related technologies help us to identify those signals which was otherwise not observed to us, because they were hidden, they were latent. And using some computational intelligence, we try to mine them so that such insights surface up. But at the end of the day, what and how should we use those insights? That's important, and which sets the scope of today's session. That business analytics as standalone may has its own importance, but what it has to do with business setting, how should business analytics or big data analytics or data analytics for that matter should contribute to the domain of management science? So there comes the purpose and the fifth pillar of big data. value. So from those insights, the interesting insights, which was not observed to us, how should managers derive value out of that? How should businesses create value out of that? That there remains the pivotal focus. Now, let me just take an offshoot. So let's slightly deviate from big data analytics, and let's look for an overall objective of any firm or any business, and even you as individual. So even I believe me as an individual, I'm a balance sheet. So I'm working somewhere, I'm getting a salary, that's my source of revenue, and I'm having some expenses. And what I save at the end of the month, that's my margin. So by drawing that analogy, even firms have certain objectives. So they have a source of revenue, they are selling their products or services. And in order to fulfill or cater to those processes, they need to expense in terms of procuring raw materials, paying off salaries, and what remains is that at the end of the day is their margin. Now, overall, what's the final objective of any business? Why will anybody get into business? Because they want to have a significant portion of that margin at the end of the day. And any business for that matter aspires and aims to increase that margin day in and out. Now, how does big data come into play over here? Now, let's decode margin in two ways. So how can we actually increase margins for any business? So either we can scale up our revenues or we can manage our expenses. So in terms of optimization, we say revenue maximization or cost minimization. Or you can have a goal from a programming approach and you can achieve that goal simultaneously. So anyways, the bigger picture is that we need to increase our margins. Now, having said that, it is very difficult to cater to both the objectives simultaneously. So you cannot have, say, target two stones by a single bullet. So often firms take different standpoints, and there comes the strategic role and viewpoint. That if I need to increase my revenues, then I need to be different from the market because I'm already thriving in a competitive world. So until and unless I have some uniqueness, I have some differentiation, or the way we say, what's the novelty in my product or service? Why should people choose me over my competitors? There comes the purpose of big data. Because if I can prove myself to be different from rest of the world, of course, the consumer base will move towards me and alienate to the competitors. Now, say, be it I'm an e-commerce portal, or say I'm selling on books, or I'm selling on food through Zomato app, or say I'm Amazon, I'm Flipkart, I have a catalog of items. Now, me as a firm, if I'm able to understand my consumers in a better way, if I'm able to capture their interests, preferences of products and services in a better way, and from, say, a catalog of 1,000, I can show them the 10 most interesting products which suits their purpose or interests, my job is done. Because earlier the problem, the core problem from economics was information asymmetry. Now consumers, when they browse, the problem is information overload. You hang on to Amazon or say YouTube or Flipkart, you start browsing a particular category of products and you can see a plethora of options flooded with. Now your problem is that you have a designated time period of shopping, a window time. So in an hour or two, you need to choose down and narrow to products. So there comes the role play of big data analytics, that given your previous browsing history, we can come up and identify a small group of products or services which best suit your needs. And if I can do that accurately, I'm easing the decision-making process of consumers. What's the decision-making process for a consumer? The buying decision, whether should I buy or not, and what should I buy? So from 1,000, I have narrowed my scope to 10 most relevant products for each individual. And I'm not doing it for one or two. I am doing it for all consumers of my entire target base, and I'm doing it uniquely and subjectively for each one. So I don't have a list of all popular items which are trending and I'm blindly referring and recommending it to all. No, I'm mining your individual preferences and I'm coming up with such recommendations. But at the end of the day, what is that business deriving? Because I'm helping my consumers with an easy decision-making process or a purchase decision, they quickly make a transaction, which ultimately translates as a sales figure to me. And I tend to increase and increase and increase my sales or a turnover. Now, second aspect, that was one. Second, I need to be very efficient. So I need to basically minimize my costs and the way I operate that particular business. Now, how can I be very efficient? So be it a manufacturing setup, an assembly line, or say a service delivery system, whatever, or a software consulting or whatever. I need to offer that product or a service in a cost which is unbeatable. My competitors are not able to do that. So if I can predict how much demand is going to be there, I can very well match the inventory levels. So I can free up my working capital from there. I need not keep tons and tons of products stored just out of anticipation. Or say it's a supply chain issue that whether I should route my trucks or the way the things are procured from one area to another, from one location to another, which route should I follow? Which route will give me the maximum fuel efficiency, minimum time delivery? So there where the power of big data can be extracted and exploited. I can, sitting here in my table, I can predict that when the assembly line can witness a breakdown. And if it can witness a breakdown, what will be the duration of that breakdown? So upfront, I can raise a flag that see, after third day, between this to this duration, that particular assembly line may go haywire. So let's have a shutdown for a 1 hour, recalibrate it and start functioning. I'm minimizing my losses. If I'm minimizing my losses, ultimately it translates to a margin, which is the bigger picture. And it's not just about manufacturing industry. It's with even food delivery systems, you can see, or say e-commerce portals delivery system, the services which they are offering, or say financial institutions. What are fintechs banking on today? So as Indian banking system currently is reeling under stressed loans. So bad debts, that's a big problem today. And why has that happened? Because the decision making of some individuals, a group of employees, has gone wrong. They had offered loans to incapable or people who could not obey their financial commitments. But now, using their previous credit history, previous transactions, their demographic profile, I can come up with a score upfront that whether they will pay back or they will default on my commitments. So I'll have a guiding mechanism on whom to provide a loan and whom to deny. And if I do that, I'm again minimizing on my losses. So ultimately, the ball game revolves around increasing your revenues or decreasing your costs or expenses. You need to be more efficient. So that's where the element of strategic management comes into play. Either we need to be different or we need to be efficient. So either you are building on cost leadership, you are producing or offering that service in the minimum possible cost, or you're different from others. And since you're different, you have a unique product, you have a unique service, you have a unique feature, people are coming to you. So either you increase your sales or you reduce your expenses. At the end of the day, you're increasing your margins. And that's what is deriving value from business. Now, when we look into the whole value chain of any industrial setting, of any business practice, there are various pockets. So from where are we sourcing our raw materials? How is the operations going on? Say the inbound logistics, operations part. How are we finally taking it to the consumer end, after sales services? And there are certain departments which feed these processes. So we have a procurement department, we have a finance department, we have HR team, we have the information systems team. Now each pocket standalone has some contribution towards increasing the margin. And if we start deploying analytics driven decision making technologies at each such pockets and silos, overall we have a possibility of deriving larger value. So whatever examples I have been giving on for the past 10 minutes was at a very operational or a tactical level. Let's say if I want to identify my customers better, I deploy a recommender system. I want to give loans to only credit worthy people. I need to have a good credit scoring machine learning driven model. Or say I need to identify earlier breakdowns and shutdowns. So I need to have a predictive maintenance, which is again powered by AI. So these are all operational or tactical level decision making. But for a firm, for a business, there's something more, which is more significant and crucial. And that's the strategic decision making. Whether in my firm, I should at all deploy big data analytics technology and entire decision making should be driven by that engine. Because for me, every decision has a cost. If I'm deploying big data analytics, so there's an opportunity cost associated with it. Rather than spending in this technology or developing that ecosystem, I could have gone for a related diversification. I could have gone for an integration of other businesses. But then at a CXO level, I need to take a strategic decision making. What's the ROI of deploying big data technology or the related ecosystem? And how do we actually compute that ROI? Those individual value which is generated in each pocket aggregates together, and we finally compute the value derived for that firm. And how much we have expensed, how much we have incurred the costs in order to set up that big data ecosystem. And say we have a time lifetime period with a payback for a 5 year or a 7 year or 10 year, or the way we do our accounting principles. And then at the end of the day, we have an ROI metric that if I invest 100 crores and acquire another plant, this will be my ROI of 8.9%. If I'm just spending, say, 55 crores, not 100 crores, and I'm just integrating other possible extensions, say I'm vertically integrating my final end products, or I'm also buying my sources. Say I'm a steel manufacturing plant and I'm buying an iron ore field. So I'm investing there. What's my ROI? 6.8%. And now I'm just spending 40 lakhs in the whole big data technology ecosystem. And what's my ROI? So decision making at all three levels are important. Be it tactical, operational, or strategic. And until and unless the whole management is convinced, or at least the leadership is convinced, that we need to or we need not to deploy big data analytics technologies to improve our processes, one should not proceed with it. Because the final firm performance, big data analytics mediates it. It's ultimately the management, the people, and the technology who have an interplay of all the three. And finally, they lead to firm performance, which can be measured in various ways. Say, how much are you selling? So your sales or margins or profits, or even some market indicators. What's your ROE? How is your stock price doing? What's the return on equity? But who mediates them? Such technologies mediate them. So I've given an overview of what and how big data analytics should be looked at, not from a technological viewpoint, but what it actually means for business. So I pass it on to the other eminent speakers who might be having some different vantage points. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar, for your valuable, insightful thought process.
Okay. My pleasure.
And now I would like to invite Dr. Singh from NIT Patna. Sir, please, over to you.
Welcome.
Sir. Sir, your mic is mute. Please unmute it. Yes.
So, good evening all, and thank you, Dr. Kumar, for a very nice and really inside insight.
My pleasure, sir.
In fact, I had certain slide, but now I will skip that and I will just try to take up from the place and give a bit of technical insight, because I am not a person from management and, to be very honest, business. But what I can assure you that we are making, myself and Sunil, Dr. Sunil Soumya, we worked on certain aspects of data which can be used in the businesses. So I will be now moving on to, I have a small presentation. So I will be moving on with that presentation and obviously the discussion. So I hope my screen is visible to all of you.
Yes, sir.
So this is a scenario where the different types of data are basically a business is capturing. So you can see around 38% of data is called as dark data. Another 38% of data is called as the more detailed customer suppliers data. Next, 16% data is around social media content. Now this has increased. 4% is commercially available data and publicly available data. So a few years back, around in the era of say 2000, if you talk about, this 16% was almost zero. Even this 38% was almost zero. So we had only certain, as Dr. Kumar also told about, that we had a physical system and then we were measuring. Now you can now we can see that we have this data, the size of the data is increasing. Now why is it important? Why we talk about big data? What is the big deal in this? So I will just try to give you an example. Say counting problem. If we want to count how many people are there in my home, that is also a counting problem, and counting to the population of India is also a counting problem. So both are counting problem, but methodology will differ. They are not the same in that sense. So we can count family members on our hand, so we just remember it. If I talk about how many students are there in a classroom, we can just count them. How many people are there in Patna? We cannot go in that same way. What is the population of India? We take a different approach. So that's why this big data requires some sort of different methodology. The existing methodology of data analysis or data handling cannot deal with this big data. The reasons already have been explained by Dr. Kumar nicely, the different V's and how they are impacting the data dimension. Earlier, this social media data was basically, the social media was invented just for a chit chat application. People will say just post on their status and shares and so on. But now this social media content, myself and Sunil both will be focusing on this one, because this is where we were mainly interested in. So this social media content can be used as a big, big tool or big data source for pushing the businesses ahead. What sort of analysis we can do? So I have to just skip certain slides, and if I just show you, so this is how this is what now current businesses are thinking about it. So we had earlier, we had descriptive analysis. Descriptive analysis used to talk about what happened. And for this descriptive analysis, we used to just use the data, simple databases. Like those who have a computer background or even in other engineering background, this database is a very common subject, relational database model. So we used to store data and we used to derive this sort of information. What happened in this one? Why? Then we talked about, or we move on to diagnostic analysis. Why did it happen? And now we are in the era of why will it happen? So predictive analysis, we are making predictive. Dr. Kumar talked about the term machine learning. So machine learning and big data, deep learning models, they are talking about this predictive analytics. If we can predict what is going to happen in future, how this sales will increase, or whether this product, if we take this sort of, if we go in this path, what is the margin of profit, or in what way we will gain, or what way we will lose, why we will lose, or why we can gain, and so on. And then we have prescriptive analysis. So how can we make it happen? So these are now, people are now in this era, we are concentrating on these two tools, predictive analysis and prescriptive analytics. Descriptive analysis and reporting, online management, data visualization has been widely used for some time. I think this started in the era of around late 90s and 2000. They flourished, so people had talked about data mining, online information, analytical processing, and so on. Predictive analysis around 2000, after 2000, in the era of 2000 and 2005-10, people started about this predictive analytic. Again, machine learning is not new, but the use of machine learning started, gain a momentum in that particular time. Prescriptive, now we are in that era of prescriptive and predictive analysis normally. So exactly why this or what we can do? So this data mining, again, when this data mining came, data mining, I think, came in era of 96, 97, where people started about how we can increase ourselves or how to detect certain cases. I will give you certain examples. Last year I was in Singapore. In Indian time, it used to be around 2 o'clock in the night. I made a card payment, a coffee I bought there, and I immediately got a call from my credit card division that your card was used in this and this and this place. Are you the person? Whether you confirm that this was made by you or this is something. So this is the era we are living now. As soon as you make a transaction, if it is not normal. Now, if I make a same transaction in India, I will never get a call like that. Why? Because the location has changed. It was in a different country. So immediately the software identified that, okay, might be there can be some sort of issue, might be the card has been hacked or might be the card has been misused. So this is what a diagnostic and prescriptive system can offer to us. Like Dr. Kumar has already told that, identifying this sort of, whether we can identify that this, what is the credit worthy of this particular customers and so on. So these things can be done using these techniques like classification. Still, the classification is the most widely used technique for this. And predictive techniques are nowadays using classification technique mostly. We have clustering techniques also. Now, clustering, what is the difference between classification technique and clustering technique is, in classification, we have certain level of classes, like whether it is good, bad, or class A, class B, class C. And then based on certain rules, we are putting the current operation or current system or current data in one of those classes. Whereas in case of clustering, we do not know anything. So based on the feature characteristics of the data, we create certain small groups and we call them as clusters. And whenever a new data set come, we put them into those clusters and manually we assign certain meanings to those clusters. Okay, this cluster represents, like if we mine the data of say a Big Bazaar, then we can just cluster them in certain groups and then we can find, okay, say if the customer are having this is the income of this customer, or this is the age group of customer, they are probably buying this sort of product. So if they can be grouped into that certain similar feature by some similar feature, we call them as clustering. Association rule, in fact, association rule was the first which started the field of data mining. And association rule started with market basket analysis. This is also called as market basket. So whenever if you just check the basket, market basket of several users, you will find some items are associated together. Like if you buy a bread, probably you will buy butters also. If you buy milk, you may buy bread also. If you buy soap, you may buy shampoo also. These are inherent, these are very trivial. But when this rule was applied, it was found that whenever people buy beer, they also buy diapers. So that was something surprising. And then that field started. And now, this association rules are used in, if you might have noticed that in Big Bazaar, whenever they are just making their stores, which item to display, at which location they should be displayed, and which are the items which are going together, so that if they can be placed together, if people is thought, if the customer has thought of buying one item, by looking at the second item which are associated, highly associated with that, they can buy that also. So in that sort of floors, management, say floor shop management, these things are being used, and these are being used for a long time now. Sequential pattern discovery, like with time, how things are changing. So how the buying pattern of a particular person is changing, whether it is the same thing they are buying, no, with age, with time of the year, with their age, with their income pattern, with their location, they are changing. So how the buying pattern of a particular person is behavior of say changing, how the things should be, what things should be put into that particular market area. Regression, again, how much customers, how much footfall will be there, say during puja days, how many customers may visit this store, or how many customer may visit if you are making an online sale, how many customers we can expect, what is the sale we can expect, on what product we should offer this, we should offer more say offers, where we should give more emphasis, and so on. Deviation, I just gave you that example, so that credit card uses and call was an example of a deviation detection. If there is a deviation in the behavior pattern of the user, immediately a call is given to that particular user. So these are the things which are nowadays very frequent, are basically used. As in terms of our contribution or our research, if I say myself and Sunil Somya, I think Sunil will discuss on that particular topic. We started with say these reviews, because reviews nowadays plays a very strong role in the business, in any business. Reviews by Amazon, and you will see that a simple question by Amazon that whether this review was helpful or not got a plenty of advantage and plenty of business to them. So how we can make those review helpful to the users and so on. So for that we did some research and that, and I will like to invite Dr. Sunil to shed a light on that. Thank you everyone.
Thank you, Singh sir. Thank you. Now I call Dr. Sunil to give us some valuable opinion on the topic. Please.
Thank you so much, Professor Mondal. Thank you, sir, and thank you, Professor Kumar. Right, you have already explained the basics of the big data really very in a nice manner, right? So what I am going to speak now, that mostly the technical points, right, the how, suppose we have the data, and mostly I'll be talking about the reviews. So if we have the reviews, then what are the things, what are the analytics we can do on that review so that it can be benefited for our business, right? So that is the main focus. And at last, I'll be talking that why one should choose the big data or business analytics as a potential career, right? So these two points I am going to focus. So let me just start. Hopefully my screen is visible. Is it?
Yes. It's visible.
Okay, so quickly I'll go to some of the things already it has been covered by all the professors, but still I'll just start with the introduction that when we say a business is successful, yeah, suppose someone has to say a business is successful or not, when we say that one, the one like potential answer could be that if it is capable or of offering its customer what they want. Suppose I want something and I'm getting from you, so I say your business is successful, right? For example, a user on e-commerce and he's looking for a mobile and these two features he want, right? So suppose he is looking for 4GB RAM, 13MP camera. Some other user is looking for 500mAh battery, and another user is looking for HD display. And in this product, as you can see on the right, it has all the features what these three users at least looking. Okay, I'm not talking other users, but at least these three users, whatever they are looking, I'm getting all the features in this one. So what was the conventional approach? Let me just tell you. So earlier, if we have to do any business, so what we should have, that we should have an interesting idea, right? A good workers and a strong sense of business, and you could make a living, right? Like we have seen in this particular mobile manufacturer company, he has integrated all the features. I mean, some of the things what we can guess that user will really like, I'm going to integrate those features in this mobile and my business will be successful. So companies could succeed even they did not do much to understand their past performance in order to prepare for the future, right? So they just guess something and they might throw that idea and then they propose the product. Probably their guess may be successful some of the times. For example, the sir has just given one example that Amazon in 2006, they came with one guess that was this review helpful to you? So with the review of the product, they just integrated this question. Was this review helpful to you? And you know what? It is estimated that this simple question brings about $2.7 billion additional revenue to the Amazon, right? But again, my question is, second question, is simple guesswork enough to figure out customer desire, right? And it turns out that simple guesswork may not work all the time, right? It could work some of the times, like it had worked in some of the cases we have seen, right? But it may not work all the times. What could be the reason? The reason could be the user's desire is completely subjective. Subjective means what I want and what you want and what some other wants. It is completely different. We cannot generalize the desires of all the users. For example, suppose I want a back cover with a mobile and you want the screen guard with a mobile, right? Someone else wants the complete protection that if something goes wrong within the 6 month or 12 months, so I want that protection also, so it should be replaced or something. Or someone else is looking for the good positive or some reviews, then only I can make my decision, right? So the desires for all the customers are different. So what could be the modern approach? We cannot go with simply guessing and doing our business, right? So we have to follow some of the analytics part, right? So we need to do some in-depth analysis to capture customer behavior or the current trends, right? And here the role of business analytics come into the picture, and that enables the company to know their customer wants and needs based on some data and the statistical facts, right? So yeah, I told you that what could be the modern approach. So yeah, so one of the example I'm just with this example I just want to relate what I have explained about the modern approach. That online reviews nowadays, it is very capable for it is very important, not for only the business, also for the customers. Why? Because we make our decision by looking the reviews, right? So reviews can be anywhere. It can be the e-commerce reviews, like reviews will be helpful to decide like which restaurant we have to go, which product to buy, which movie we should look for, right? So so the role of online reviews, it has very impactful role on the business. And for the for business also, it is very important. Why? Because the most of the reviews are positive, definitely it is going to increase the product sale. At the same time, if the most reviews are negative, it may harm the product sale, right? So it is equally important for the business managers also and for the customers also, right? And how the big data can relate with that one. So although there has been a lot of discussion on the big data, why we are dealing with the big data in the business, but let me just give you one of the examples that these are some of the popular products on the Amazon. And let's see that how many reviews it has received. This is not the updated one, right? So, but let's see that some of the products like Amazon Fire TV Stick, it's one of the popular product on the Amazon. It has received more than 38,000 reviews. Some product has received 35,000 reviews. Nowadays, the mobile products are receiving 1 lakh plus reviews, right? So obviously there is a big data and we have many challenges due to those big data, right? So what could be the challenge that as I told you, the reviews play a very important role in the product sale. So the customer has to decide, or they basically read the reviews before making their decision. But the question is that suppose we have the 1 lakh reviews available, then how many reviews a customer is going to read? So are they going to read all the 1 lakh reviews? Obviously not. They are, so the survey says that the customer read 8 to 10 reviews, or maybe maybe maximum 10 reviews, I can say that, before making their decision. So obviously, so if we have 1 lakh of reviews, we have to present most 10 helpful reviews in the first page itself, so that as soon the customer visit the review page, they see some of the reviews and then they can make the decision. Now it doesn't matter the reviews are positive or negative, but the customer will decide based on the reviews which is most helpful and that is available on the first page itself, right? And another aspect is the mixed sentiment. Sometimes the sentiments also plays a very big role. Like for example, if we are going for a restaurant, going for any hotels to stay, right? So the sentiments, what the others have told about that the service of that restaurant or hotels, that play a very important role. And authenticity nowadays, again, it's very important, because just for just to increase or decrease some business or product sale, what the people are doing, they are writing the fake reviews. Isn't it? Which looks like real, but it is actually fake, and they are someone else has written, and they have been paid for that one. Okay, so we need to identify these review also. So that what could be the, so these things could be the research for, like research, it's a dimension through which we can explore that how we can explore these points, and we can restrict. We can restrict or and we can increase our business sale. Fine. So I'll just go that how we can, what will be our approach. Obviously we have to use some of the machine learning or the deep learning approach, and we probably we have to use some of these steps. That is the first step. We have to ask the right question and define the target of our data analysis, that what we want to predict. For example, suppose we want to predict that which review is most helpful, and that review I'm going to place in the top. Then second most helpful review I'm going to place in the second position. And like that, I'm going to rank my reviews. So target we should be knowing. Second thing is for doing anything, we should have the data. So data collection is very important. Then we need some analysis of the data. And here we are going to use some of the machine learning tools or the deep learning tools to analyze the data, right? We are going to do some, based on some analysis, some experiments, then we can come to know that, okay, if these things we can integrate with the review, we can filter the fake reviews. Okay, if these so how do we identify whether a review is fake or real? So some based on some features we can decide that one. So we have to analyze that part, and then we can improve our system, and we can control the benefit. I mean, whether it will increase or decrease the product sale. Fine. So these are some of the few research problem, and I'm going to talk the way we can handle, and we have handled that. What we did, we have proposed many approaches. For example, suppose we have the review, we can extract the features from that one, right? And we can give those features to the regression machine learning algorithm, and that regression algorithm, that what they can do, they're going to predict a vote. Okay, a predict maybe score for each review, and based on the score, then we can decide that at which position we have to keep that review, because we have a long list of 1 lakh review for a particular product. Then which position? Then, and the second aspect is some reviews which are coming right recently or at the later stage of the product launch, if they are, we are not ranking with these techniques, they will be always placed in the bottom, right? And then the customer will not get benefited what they should get from those helpful reviews. So we have to place the helpful reviews at the proper position where it deserves. So we have proposed many ways, like you have seen that in the first approach, we have proposed, we have extracted the feature, we fed to the regression, and we predicted the vote. In the second approach, again, we extracted the features, fed to the classifier, and the classified whether a review is a low quality review or a high quality review. What is the low quality review? Sometimes people just write good. Sometimes people write very good, nice product. But that doesn't give any intuition to the peer reviewers or the new customer who is looking or who is looking for to buy that product. So we need to classify the review into low quality and high quality, and then predict the vote for only high quality reviews and then rank the reviews. That also we can do. But as if we can, we are using the deep learning approach like CNN or RNN, then we can eliminate this feature extraction part and we can directly feed the review as a vector. And then the deep learning will, that model will tell us what will be the vote or score of that particular review. So we did the experiment with these products and these many reviews, and this was the result of what we have got. So I have attached, I have cited my paper here in with this presentation. You can explore the paper and to get the more intuition than how the machine learning thing can be applied to analyze the, to do the analytics part, to do the data analytics part. Similarly, for identifying the spam reviews, again, we proposed a system where we suppose as soon a review will drop, as soon a user will drop a review, that will pass through a machine learning model. In this case, we have used the LSTM machine autoencoder model, right? And that autoencoder model, it gives us the loss value, right? And based on the loss, we predict whether it is a fake or real. So how it works basically, it works as an anomaly system. So suppose there is a system, right? Any machine learning system, and it has been trained for your fingerprint or for your eye, for your eye detection, right? And someone else will come and try to frost the system, right? And to mimic you, the system will alarm, you know, this is the anomalies, right? Similarly, if suppose we trained our system only for the real reviews and we pass the fake reviews out of that one, the system will alarm us that no, this is a fake review, you should filter it out right away, and you should not post it in the screen. And hence the customer will also not get any, I mean, they will not be cheated, and they will not feel that the Amazon or Flipkart, they're cheating at some aspect. But so those systems again that we have proposed, so you can again explore that one with the paper what we have already, I have already cited here. Fine. So the question is how business analytics help companies, right? Already this point has been discussed. Let me just go through the points again, that it gives the business analytics, suppose you are the business analytics, so it gives the clarity, right? So where a particular company is standing right now. So how it is giving the clarity, again, with the help of the analytics, data analytics. It gives you the stats. How is your performance in the past and what decision you can make so that you can improve in the future. Right, it gives you the competitiveness, the how far or how near you are to, with respect to your competitors. Timeline is how you can follow the timeline is, right? Then it also tells the keep business up to date in a changing environment, elevates operational efficiency and many more things. Finally, the last point what I'll talk is what makes business analytics a good career choice? Why we should choose the business analytics as a potential career. So the first thing is the supply is still lower than the demand, right? Although why this is happening, because we have all the tools, we have all the technology nowadays, but still the we do not have the that number of professionals. So we do not have the analyzers, okay? So although the demand is more, the supply is very low. So So it is easy to switch a business analytics irrespective of your personal. So the one question is, so yeah, definitely everyone cannot go for the machine learning. Everyone cannot do the deep learning. Then what will happen? Every time there will be the supply will be lower than the demand. But the good thing about the business analytics is every time you don't need the professional skills, you can, whatever profession you are doing, you can still switch to some of the as a business analytics. So how you can do that one? You can you should know the collaboration. You should have the ability to align with the stakeholders. Basic knowledge of the statistics tools such as Excel and all, if you know, and ability to drive impact. Second thing is business analytics can be applied to any industry. It is not restricted to only the e-commerce, what I have talked. It can be applied to the entertainment. It can be applied to some sports. It can be applied to the education, finance, manufacturing, and elsewhere. Right. And the third reason, a career in business analytics is dynamic and makes room for the professional development, right? So whatever profession you are in, if you will be if you will update yourself with the machine learning and the artificial intelligence technology, you will find yourself as a business analyzer. You'll find you can make yourself as a business analytics. So yeah, which again can be helpful in the recommendation system. And I have the chatbot system, which is very popular nowadays. So for these technology, you should have some professional skills also. So this is the conclusion that so how the technology can help in the business analytics. And mostly I have explained you about the, I have talked about the analytics part, the how do we do the analytics with the help of the technology. These are some of the references. Yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Sunil, thank you for your valuable deliberation. Now I would like to, we have actually a few questions. And the question goes to Dr. Kumar, and the question asked by Sahid Dhatri, how are the GDPR norms being implemented in the various nuances of big data?
So GDPR norms, as in specifically what? Do we have the audience over here? The particular one?
Sahid Dharti. Sai Dharti, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm there, sir. It is primarily to do with the data protection norms as such, because I think now the EU has adopted a lot of measures, and I think there's a bill pending in the parliament.
How so do you think about the privacy issues?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Welcome. See, it's the idea is about taking data from a source. Now, whenever we have an access to plethora of sources of data, so privacy norms are filters to those sources. So if somebody or some group of people are unwilling to share any demography related profile or whatever browsing history or whatever, so that's their call. We cannot force them. So in order to overcome, so first that we cannot, privacy should be secondary to, privacy should be primary to business aspects. So we cannot compromise somebody's privacy at the cost of generating more returns or margins or whatever. That's one. Second, if at all we want to generate or capture such ideas, we need to offer some level of incentives. So that can be in terms of not always monetary incentive. We need to make them more loyal. We need to have that emotional touch point. We need to create some kind of association with that organization, because until and unless we reach them out in person, this is not going to work. So that's my take on it. Now say this session is being recorded. Now, as an AI specialist, I can always say that, okay, out of 100, how many were actually having a good attention span? So maybe that camera is tracking the eye movement of all the participants. It's a breach of privacy. But that's an informational insight to me. Now we'll have to see that breaching the privacy of 100 individuals, what's the incremental advantage of that insight? So there's a call of trade-off over there. That's my take.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Kumar. Now the second question asked by Dr. Shekhar Murthy, and I'm just sharing the doc. I think you can see. Is it visible?
Yes.
Dr. Murthy is asking, it's actually about the data, big data governance, and how does an organization formulate a robust data governance strategy, and how do we merge data collected in silos in a secured and safe manner, in particular sensitive data, and manage privacy across geographies. The data storage servers in the another country, so how, what does the law actually govern in the security purpose?
I think this part has more to do with the cloud-based analytics. Dr. Singh?
Yes, basically the question mainly refers to that, again, that same privacy
issue. Exactly.
Raul has already explained. So storing and security, totally different domain. Privacy, nowadays, security and privacy, these two are very important issues in this data gathering process. Now, For example, if I say, Google, if you put location services on in your Google, you get a lot of benefit, but you are also losing a lot of privacy. Now, yeah. Google knows more than you last year, where you are, which countries, which places you visited, at what time you visited, how long you stayed there, everything is known to Google. So this is a privacy breach, but you are also getting certain benefits out of that. You are taking the Google's location services to reach, or you are using map services to reach somewhere. So you have to compromise. If privacy is only, there is a bill, privacy bill passed by the government. I have not gone through the whole bill and I cannot comment on that, but there is a bill, and this across the world people are now talking about, and privacy bill is being implemented in their country. But it is individual property. You have to gather. Now, in a mass collection, say like medical fields, if someone is gathering your data, so they cannot give that data to other party until and unless they are taking either your permission, or even if with your permission, they never disclose the demographic information, your name, your age, say might be your location and so on, so that it can basically reveal some information about you. So that's the way normally whoever collects the data, it is their responsibility to take care of these issues. And it is being done in almost all cases if it is a big business.
So from where Dr. Singh has left, so he has a very valid point to make. See, the way I was saying about incentives, so incentive may not always be economic. So first, I'm not saying that we need to give some bonuses or financial lucrative offers so that people compromise on data privacy, or they come up and share their information. No, that's not expected. But it's about a way of community experience. Let's say if all individuals are not willing to share our information, our browsing history, our purchase patterns, our trial details, or whatever, then when the machine learning algorithm or whatever big data analytics algorithms will not have any historical experiences. So if in the back end, I don't have multiple such instances, me as a consumer will again suffer from good suggestions from the system itself, because other people like me have not allowed to access their part of data or information. And since limited information is available, as a stakeholder of that community, I'm also taking a hit, because my whatever interests are being generated are based on very small number of observations, and the system is giving it on a very lower value of accuracy. So they are trying to suit or match my expectations, but they are not able to nail it to perfection. In order to achieve that stage, we'll have to contribute from a community's viewpoint. That yes, all of us are willing to share. Of course, we'll have NDAs and other security premises protocols should be followed. But when all of us come and share our information or data, then the whole community will derive benefit out of it. Because that leads to creation of large repositories on which we can perform and run and deploy various algorithms. That's just to conclude it.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Kumar. The next question goes to Dr. Sunil.
Yeah, Professor Mandal, I'm yes. Shekhar Murthy. I just wanted to say that my question yes, was sir. Not... Can I clarify? Because,
yes,
because both the answers were only related to privacy, and that also in a very limited business context. I have been working on marine data, marine spatial data infrastructure for a very long time. I can tell you that many countries across the world do not share this data because of various reasons. And we have a lot of litigation issues that come up. So these are very practical problems, and these need to be addressed. It is not just what we can get and what we cannot get. So the data governance part of the question was not answered. Thank you.
Okay. So is that Dr. Murthy? Mr. Murthy?
I'm Shekhar Murthy, yeah.
Mr. Shekhar Murthy, can you just elaborate on what exactly governance, so maybe what dimensions you want us to, or you expect us to answer on? Maybe
so
you
let
can
us
give it a shot.
Yeah, let us take marine data, marine spatial data infrastructure.
Say, let's come to your business context. Okay.
Yeah. So there are a variety of ships at sea. They are at okay. different places. And there are various laws that govern in different parts of the sea, and at any given time we need a real-time data. These are all getting collected by different countries and different groups of countries.
Okay.
But when we want to make a universal approach to use this, many countries will not give you that kind of data, which are very sensitive to their shores, and therefore
that's against their protocol. Precisely.
Yeah, so we suffer. You know, although I keep claiming that, you know, big data can do all this for you, please share the data. Even the best of countries and the most developed countries do not do that. So there is a very critical hitch here. So when we talk about governance, every country has its own laws, and including India. And you know what is happening between us and China. So things like that are real practical issues, and these need to be addressed.
So from my limited understanding, Mr. Murthy, there's one approach, even Dr. Singh and Dr. Soumya may also feel free to contribute. So Mr. Murthy, there's one aspect into analytics space, we call it transfer learning. So that's very much different from what machine learning and deep learning have. So transfer learning has a specific purpose and an objective, that there are often business domains or practical settings where we have limited access to data. Say whatever you're trying to say, that because in marine setup, people are not revealing information out of international protocols or whatever, security reasons. Now, in such cases, we'll have to identify domains which may be unrelated, but are actually having such variables, say whatever routing or transportation or number of vehicles or whatever. And we'll try to deploy algorithm in an unrelated data set, and we'll test it on the contrary, whatever our objective is, say marine for that matter. So maybe I will develop and train an algorithm on a we call it a sustainable freight village, where we have just a road-based transport system, because it's a proxy of whatever a marine does for a shore. So we have a freight village in a land area. So we'll deploy an algorithm, train it on the variables corresponding to that where the data is available. But when it comes to testing, we'll transfer the entire parameters learned into your test bed where we had limited information. That can be one way of addressing this concern. This may not be foolproof, but yes, this can be a proxy solution to whatever you are trying to hint at. That's my take.
Exactly what I got from Sir's question was, the first thing was the mainly the governance issue. Now, obviously the governance, I'm not very competent enough to say about the governance part, but what Dr. Kumar also told, in fact, our group is also working on certain issues, Murthy sir, where we are thinking of if we can encrypt, if in an encrypted domain, if we can do something. Obviously, I cannot disclose the whole idea, but if that things, those results are successful, then probably this sort of, this limitation can be, to some extent, we can come over this limitation. People can unhesitatingly can, we may be able to they donate or give, basically share their data. So people are working in that domain also, so that in encrypted form, if it can be shared, and if it something, some insight can be drawn in the encrypted form only.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Singh and Dr. Kumar. And the last question, because we are running out of time and it is almost about to leave from the office. All of you are already in the office, I think. Okay, so the last question I would like to ask Dr. Sunil. The question is, to increase the followers in Instagram, some of the celebrities use auto followers. To which extent ML is able to detect and report these anomalies?
So if we have the auto followers, right, so to which extent, if we are developing any ML system, so that can detect
auto followers, actually auto followers are the bots, so they are not human being. So auto follower, whenever we say auto follower, they are basically bot programs, so they are computer programs, and then they are interacting, behaving like a user. So you might have seen that whenever we browse a website, it asks, click here to prove that you are not a bot. So
yes,
same thing. So click here that you are not a bot means that sometimes automated. So if I write a program and that program is constantly sending something, so this is not in our hand, to be very very clear, because so this problem is with Twitter, Facebook, everywhere. Now even in India there was a case also. I'm not taking the name of that celebrity. He has to appear in court for that auto follower case also. Okay. Yeah. So these auto follower case, there are certain features, as Sunil explained in his talk, that for everything we can find out certain features. So like a human, how a human being behave, if we train a machine to behave similarly, still there will be certain gaps. So if we can identify those gaps, we can always write a program, another ML program in fact, which can identify those both. So, and that's what Google, Twitter, everything is, everyone is doing.
Yes. Okay, so, sir, can I interrupt one?
Sure, sir.
Is it intelligent agents like as you say?
Yes, intelligent agents. We call it as bot or intelligent agents.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Was that Mr. Sahu's question?
Yes. I am asking a question related to stock market behavior and how big data and big data analytics help the behavior pattern of the customers, particularly to protect the interest of the customers.
It's a very interesting thing, and we have worked on this part also, that how to, for the stock market, like at least what we worked, that when to sell, when to buy, when to hold. So that sort of study we did that one. So yeah, based on the data, people write the review. Yeah. And if we can use those comments, train the model, we can predict some of the things. That is one.
We are adding to what Sunil is trying to say. Earlier, basically, if you listen to or you think of any way, say, stock markets, there are two, three things. One is the fundamentals of the company and then the technical of the company. So there are certain already statistical technique. All those variables can be modeled using the machine learning tools and deep learning tools. People have already done that. Along with that, nowadays, this social media has given a third dimension. And it has been found several times that if there is a negative sentiment about any company in the social media, the whatever strong the fundamentals and technicals of that companies are, it comes down.
Social media
data has become another important part. And in last few years, it has been reported several times. So a small rumor can take your take billions of world's money just a minute.
Sir.
So this third dimension and everything like fundamentals can be modeled through program. We can have a common system where we can model the fundamentals of the company, the technicals of the company, and then the social media things. Then we also talk about the news articles, the news about those companies, the competitors, how competitors are performing and so on. So all these variables can be taken together and easily a machine learning model can be developed. So we have not done so much, so I cannot really comment on that, but this can be very easily done, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor Mandal.
Whose question was that related to auto followers? Do we have that audience here?
Actually, it's coming from
Arun
Prem.
Yes, Arun Prem.
Mr. Arun, I can have a different viewpoint with how to address that. Can see, so the idea is very much similar to what we face in Gmail or any email account for that matter. So we have an inbox, the primary inbox, we have a social tab, and whenever we get some mails, so by default, we filter them either to a promotional campaign or a promotional tab, or say we can spam it out. So in order to arrive or perform such automated decision making from the system per se, there have been tons of emails on which training has been done using machine learning and deep learning. So basically, it's a part of text classification that I have a corpus of, say, 10,000 or 10 lakh emails. Out of it, 6 lakh were normal emails deemed to be going to primary box, 4 lakh were spam. And I had developed a classification algorithm onto app with 99% of accuracy. I was able to identify them. Likewise, in your case, what Professor Singh said, that these are auto followers. So we'll have to have a corpus of all followers, of which the 60-70% will be genuine followers, and 20-30% a class imbalance will be auto followers. And again, we'll run a classification algorithm onto that. And based on the features, we will try to address and identify how many of them, the newcomers, are basically a fall out of an auto follower, or they belong to genuine followers. That can be one way of doing it, Mr. Arun. Hope I'm
Yes, yes, definitely, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. I think it looks like we answered all the questions. And to sum up all the entire webinar, means while we all would have heard the data is the new oil, okay, and the question that grips enterprises, how the mine is valuable to dig that oil for the business gains. Okay, so data is everywhere. So it is an art that how we have to extract those data from your business deals. So and you have to fill that gap between the enterprises and the business markets. Big data, that the big data frameworks form an imperative channels which actually helping the business to rise towards the data driven for the future. So we are concluding this session here, and I would like to express my deep gratitude and appreciation to all the stakeholders of SBM University for their constant support, our webinar team, IT personnel, as well as our great thanks to our president, our vice chancellor, and our co-vice chancellor for their constant support and encouraging us to conduct this kind of webinar. And thank you all the participants in today's webinar for participating in this, and we hope to see you again the next time. Thank you. Good night. Thank you, Dr. Kumar.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.